The stage is now Dr. Nikiforov. She's going to talk about molecular approaches to perioperative risk stratification. Yuri?
Thank you, Cesar. It's not very easy to give a talk after my title, but in this case, I'm really glad that's the order of these talks, because he really provided sort of this extensive discussion of the risk stratification, how important it is for all aspects of managing of patients with thyroid cancer. And the goal of my talk is to discuss the advances in molecular approaches, how we can use molecular techniques for enhancing this process. So just to reiterate, the ATA risk stratification scheme that is being used by everybody who manages patients with thyroid cancer. This is the ATA risk stratification that consider low, intermediate, and high risk for cancer recurrence. And as Dr. Tuttle mentioned before, we did incorporate some molecular markers. It was 2013, 2014. There was some BRAF, TERT at that stage. But overall, then and now, the risk stratification of thyroid cancer is based on clinical and surgical pathology parameters. So we need to know the tumor type, we need to know the tumor size, extrathyroidal extension, lymph node involvements, and so on and so forth to provide this risk stratification. And today I'm going to pose the following question. Can molecular markers provide risk stratification of thyroid cancer independent on pathology? So, and seemingly, it's very easy to answer this question. For example, this is a paper published in 2014 from Sweden, where they looked at 58 follicular thyroid adenomas. And they did some limited molecular profiles of those, and most were negative for mutations. None of them recur, and all patients were fine, except for this one patient, FTA21. I just increased, sort of enlarged the size for you to see. So this patient had TERT and RAS mutations, was diagnosed with follicular adenoma, and happened to die of metastatic follicular thyroid carcinoma many years later. So if you look at this case, then I would say that molecular profiling was much more accurate than pathology, because molecular profiling was of high-risk thyroid cancer. But we are not talking about single anecdotal cases. The question is more general. Can molecular markers provide robust and accurate risk stratification of thyroid cancer independent on cytology, pathology? And then even more advanced question, can this be achieved preoperatively before surgeon takes patient to the operating room to have a pretty good sense if this is going to be a low, intermediate, or high risk cancer? So this whole era of using molecular markers to cancer risk assessment started around 2004, 2005, after the discovery of BRAF V600E mutation as a main genetic event in papillary thyroid carcinomas. First publications that came out around 05 or 06 or 07 really were showing that the presence of BRAF mutation has pretty good correlation with either rate of recurrence or even mortality from thyroid cancer. This is just an example of several studies showing the Kaplan-Meier curves for BRAF negative and BRAF positive tumors from multiple continents, multiple groups, pretty much showing that there is a significant difference between tumors that carried BRAF V600E and were negative for BRAF 600E. But fundamental sort of resistance and fundamental problem for us to accept this as a reliable marker of prognostication was based on the fact that BRAF, in fact, is very common in thyroid cancer. About 40 to 45% of papillary thyroid carcinomas positive for BRAF is V600E mutation. So it was very difficult, it was illogical for the field to accept BRAF as a marker of aggressive thyroid cancer, because we know that only 5 to 10% to 15% of all papillary carcinomas really exhibit a high and more aggressive behavior. And papers like this sort of published in very good journals associated with BRAF mutations with mortality in patients with PTC, really they sort of created this resistance and in a way sort of denial as a whole to consider molecular markers as consider BRAF and other molecular markers for prognostication of thyroid cancer. And indeed, when we look a little bit more closely at BRAF V600E positive and negative tumors, two very large series published at that time, Ralph Tofana, 2000 patients. Yes, when we look at tumors with BRAF mutation, a larger proportion of them would recur as compared to BRAF V600E negative tumors. But we still see that the vast majority of patients with this mutation would never recur. The same is mortality. In the same study, JAMA study by Minjiao Xin and the group, yes, out of 6 patients who died, 5 would have BRAF V600E mutation. But when we look at all patients, 95% would never die of this disease. So in other words, BRAF mutation were specific, but were sensitive, but way, way non-specific in predicting really an adverse outcome in thyroid cancer. However, situation has changed significantly before that. So I think that by 2010, 2015, we started to get a more or less a clear understanding. And this is a study of 1500 patients at University of Pittsburgh, that tumors that were driven by RAS mutations, BRAF K601E, PAX8, PPR gamma, they're likely to belong to the low risk for recurrence, and tumor like BRAF V600E, red PTC fusions, they were intermediate. So we really didn't have markers for for high risk cancer, but the body of literature was shaping out in a way that we were coming more and more closer to understanding that that's what would be the molecular signature of low risk and intermediate risk thyroid cancer. And then situation changed when we, with the discovery of TERT mutations in 2013 in many cancer types, including thyroid cancer. In fact, the first study published by Mel and colleagues from the University of Porto in 2014 had pretty dramatic data for those of us who were following this field closely. So cumulative, this diagram shows a cumulative survival, and this is a study of almost 500 patients, showing very dramatic difference between survival among TERT positive and TERT negative patients with differentiated, I want to stress this, all differentiated thyroid cancer. And biologically, it does make sense. TERT gene codes for important unit of the telomerase, an enzyme that extends and provides stability of chromosomes. So this actually enzyme is used to immortalize cells. So if you think about it, tumor cells that acquire TERT mutations basically are immortal. They can sit for a very long time, slowly proliferate, eventually start sort of expanding and giving the rise to metastatic disease. So it did make sense biologically, and we had started to see a very clear evidence for the impact of TERT mutation on aggressiveness of thyroid cancer. Then next study appears, which we are even more dramatic in terms of supporting this concept. This is a study from South Korea on 551, again, differentiated thyroid cancer, showing that even when you look at the ATA high risk group, the presence of TERT mutation, absence of TERT mutation, stratified further into tumors that are actually close to intermediate and have a very high risk for disease recurrence. Moreover, when they also look at the staging, and this is AJCC, I believe the previous, probably seventh edition of staging, even stage 3 and 4 tumors, again, presence and absence of TERT mutation made a huge difference in the actual disease-free survival for these patients. So studies were coming on and on. I mean, thousands of patients studied in the meta-analysis showing very consistently again and again the same data, the TERT positive tumors, thyroid tumors, even excluding poorly differentiated and anaplastic thyroid cancer is a mark of really poor disease-free survival and poor overall survival in differentiated thyroid cancer. However, these situations came to the even a higher level of accuracy when we realized that it's not only TERT, but specifically combination of TERT with early drivers, such as BRAF and RAS, that really marks the most aggressive subgroup of thyroid cancer. This is a study from Injiao Shin from 2014, showing the again recurrence-free survivals for tumors that had BRAF plus TERT mutations. And this is again study from South Korea. Again, both of them really powered very well. 500 patients, 551 patients, showing something that really start to resembles the ATA risk stratification. When we see low risk tumors, and these tumors were positive for only RAS mutations, then you know, tumors that recur in about close to 10% of cases, BRAF-like tumor, BRAF-positive tumors, which would fit really nicely the intermediate risk tumor risk assessment. And then RAS TERT somewhere in between alone, and then RAS plus TERT and BRAF plus TERT really with about 50 to 60% of a risk of recurrence would be your high risk tumors. Further studies appeared. This is a TC analysis of the TCGA data that we discussed already today before, showing again from 19 sites, close to 400 patients, very similar findings, BRAF or RAS alone, TERT plus BRAF or RAS, recurrence-free survival dropped very dramatically. So I would say that the analysis of the literature was highly and highly consistent in identifying this as a subgroup of the most aggressive types of thyroid cancer. We were talking about disease-free survival. What about overall survival? Very similar data. Large studies with lots of patients from different centers showing that even if we are talking about the overall disease-related survival, there is a very significant risk of death from the disease when the tumors had BRAF and TERT mutations. So like I said, literature is highly consistent that one of the rare situations when there is practically no large and well-performed studies that would dispute or disprove the concept that the tumors that are positive for TERT and particularly for TERT plus early events such as BRAF and RAS would not have a higher risk for recurrence and mortality. This is a recent summary published last year, which is a meta-analysis of 27 studies reporting more than 8,000 patients with thyroid cancer. Really a nice summary showing what we expected to see based on the individual studies. when we look at the third mutation in isolation, there is a high statistically significant odd ratio of distant metastasis, tumor recurrence, but not tumor mortality. And when we look at BRAF plus TERT and RAS plus TERT, we have a very high odd ratio for distant metastasis from 8 to 40, actually, for tumor recurrence and for tumor mortality for both BRAF TERT and RAS TERT. And again, we are talking about more than 8,000 patients in 27 different studies. So is this limited to papillary carcinoma, follicular carcinomas? Not really. We are talking about Hürtel cell tumors, which have been also extensively studied. Same is true for these tumor types. This is a study from Memorial Sloan Kettering looking at widely invasive and minimally invasive Hürtel cell carcinomas, TERT mutation present in a large proportion of widely invasive, but in small proportion of minimally invasive Hürtel cell tumors. So then what we need to really complete the picture, we look at additional mutations that are common in more advanced cancers, are common in iodine refractory cancers, such as the PIK3CA mutations, AKT1 mutations, which when present as a late event, like in association with BRAF, again, or RAS or other early hits, also add to the high risk signature of thyroid cancer. And we also have to add to this a P53 mutation. This is a study from Mass General Hospital on Hürtel cell carcinomas, showing that really the P53 mutations were significantly more common in widely invasive versus minimally invasive Hürtel cell carcinomas. So putting all this data together, we can start seeing how we can build a genetic prediction, genetic profile or genetic signature that would feed the ATA risk stratification of thyroid nodules, with RAS and RAS-like mutations being on the bottom of the spectrum. And as Dr. Tuttle mentioned, this is a spectrum, this is a continuum, this is not a separate boxes, but at the bottom of the spectrum would be tumors driven by individual RAS and other RAS-like mutations. Then we are dealing with a group of BRAF-like mutations when they do not have TERT or other additional unfavorable high-risk markers. They would feed the intermediate risk. And then we are talking about TERT, and particularly BRAF-TERT, RAS-TERT, also PIK3CA, P53, AKT1, multiple mutations that would be really on the very top of this spectrum. This is a predictive model of molecular profiles, molecular markers that would tell us, that would correlate with the histopathological risk stratification for tumor recurrence. So does this really work? And can this be retested in a more structured study? Yes, the answer is yes. This is a study that was led by one of our surgeons, Dr. Lin Yip. It was a 3-year long study that we just published in Cancer just last few weeks ago on risk assessment for distant metastasis in differentiated thyroid cancer using molecular profiling. So in this study, we try to define what is the most pure and undisputable situation when we can say that differentiated thyroid cancer is aggressive. First, we were thinking about using distant metastasis and recurrence. But then, as we know, recurrence, is it residual disease? Then we decided to drop it and use only patients with differentiated thyroid cancer and distant metastasis. I personally review every slide. There was no poorly differentiated, there was no anaplastic carcinoma. It's a well-differentiated cancer that has a clinically proven distant metastasis. We identified 62 patients and we matched them using propensity score to differentiated thyroid cancer without distant metastasis with at least 5 years of follow-up. Looking retrospectively, we probably would better have a longer follow-up. But at that time, this was all that was available for us. And we applied 112 gene panels. This is a CyraSeq panel that we used for in our institution. And using the molecular restratification I showed above to mark this sort of node tumors blindly as a low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. And that's what we observe. We have a group of differentiated thyroid cancers with distant metastasis and group matched by age, gender, nodule size without distant metastasis on 5 year follow-up. So the profile of early event, early mutations is very similar. It's BRAF mutations, slightly more common in distant metastasis group, but not significant. RAS in opposite, slightly more common without. And then there is a fusions that really sort of split between these two groups. But the as expected, the biggest difference is in these markers of highly aggressive thyroid cancer. TERT mutations, P53 mutations, PIK3CA mutations. So this group summarized the now case control, the results of case control studies. By matching some of the patients had to be excluded, we ended up having the 53 cases and 55 controls, matched controls in this group. And again, as expected, the presence of TERT mutation, the presence of late secondary hits, TERT, P53, PIK3CA, was highly statistically significant is odd ratio of more than 11 in predicting distant metastasis over lack of distant metastasis on follow-up. And then if we look closer at these molecular risk groups, so among patients with distant metastasis, 66% had a high risk signature, 32% had intermediate risk. And basically one patient was missed. There was one out of 53 patients with distant metastasis that had low risk signature. This was a patient with RAS mutation only, and we didn't see on the panel any additional alterations. When we look at control groups, when we look at patients without distant metastasis after 5 years of follow-up, 51% of them had low risk molecular signature, 35% had intermediate, and 8% had high. What is interesting, at the time when the study was still in preparation, one of these 8 patients who we kind of misclassified as a high risk signature in the control group actually developed lung metastasis. So we expect that probably in time we are going to review these numbers will be even more dramatically different because we suspect that some of these patients on longer follow-up will develop also distant metastasis. So what these results mean? These results mean that if we look at the low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk profile, molecular profile based on discussed markers. What is the prediction of the rate of distant metastasis in tumors with this signature? Obviously, it depends on the prevalence of distant metastasis, but if you use a clinical range, if you use a range from 5 to 10%, because that's a common range for probability of distant metastasis in patients with well-differentiated thyroid cancer. These are the numbers. Low risk molecular signature is expected to have 0.2 to 0.4% probability of distant metastasis in 5 years. Intermediate risk signature would be 5 to 9%, and high risk signature would be 19 to 34%. So really, if we are talking about the ATA risk stratification, we are dealing with numbers that would fit very nicely into the expected ranges of tumor recurrence based on the ATA risk stratification. Now we can say that we have ATA risk stratification of thyroid cancer with low, intermediate, and risk groups. We have genetic profiles, and we have evidence for the low, intermediate, and high risk profiles would have probability, at least of distant metastasis, fitting into the expectations based on the ATA risk stratification. Now, the question is, can this work in FNA samples? All the studies, all this sort of depths of data that we have were generated from thyroid resected tumors. Can it work in the FNA samples? Can it be used preoperatively? Data is much less abundant in this respect. However, we do have some data. This is a study from UCLA led by Dr. Marsha Liefhitz on correlation of molecular profile with surgical outcomes. And they didn't even follow these patients for several years to be able to identify the sort of the later recurrence, but they look just at the histopathological features of aggressiveness in 78 patients with Bethesda 3 and 4 nodules and positive results of molecular testing. And that's what they found in their cohort. They observed 5 patients that would fit into the molecular signature of highly aggressive cancer. You see patients with TERT plus RAS, TERT plus BRAF, P53 and EIF1AX, that should be considered. And this TERT promoter mutation alone still has to be considered a high risk thyroid cancer. Out of these 5, 2 were poorly differentiated carcinomas. Both poorly differentiated carcinomas were identified. There was a gross extrathyroidal extension. So all of these 5 were cancers, and 3 out of 5 at the time of presentations really manifested as a high risk thyroid cancer disease. They came with this diagram, I think that's trying to mimic the ATA sort of continuum from indolent to aggressive, and pretty much just illustrating that RAS-like, BRAF-like, and TERP53 combination mutations really sort of can be applied to the restratification and may, and they bring first time the suggestions that individualized management, including extent of surgery, should be considered based on specific genetic alteration found preoperatively in thyroid nodules. Then the questions that I want to discuss is, are all high risk thyroid cancers large in size and clinically apparent? In other words, maybe be really just, you know, pulling our hair for no reason. Maybe these tumors, you know, would immediately manifest clinically as aggressive tumors that can be detected even without molecular parameters. And the question is, not all of them. I want to discuss just one study published from University of Utah by Dev Abraham as a senior author, who had a series of 8 patients presented with symptomatic bone metastasis from unknown primary. So at the time of presentation, there was no known primary. Bone biopsy was done and thyroid cancer was found in these patients. Then as it was thyroid cancer. Thyroid surgery was performed. 7 of them were follicular variants, and 1 was tall cell variant of papillary carcinoma. He asked us to profile these tumors, and that's the results, not unexpected. 7 out of 8 patients had TERT mutation, most commonly TERT and RAS. Interesting, 1 patient had TERT and BRAF. This was a patient with tall cell variant of papillary carcinomas. The rest were follicular variants of papillary carcinoma. Also of interest, all patients had to illustrate what was discussed by Dr. Tata or Dr. Fagan. All patients, despite the presence of distant metastasis, were effectively treated with radioactive iodine, except for 1, which was actually BRAF TERT positive tall cell variant of papillary carcinoma. But coming back to the results, so 2 of these patients had on resection very small thyroid cancer, actually 0.4 cm and 0.6 cm papillary carcinomas with multiple bone metastases, tumors with high risk genetic signature, with TERT mutation, 1 is TERT and HRAS mutation fell into this category. So really you do not need to have a large tumor size in order to manifest as a highly aggressive disease. I also want to discuss this very recent case of 50-year-old female with a very small thyroid nodule that was presented to our endocrine clinic. As you can see, nodule was first noted in 2013. So now it's 2020, 7 years ago. It grew 7 years later. It grew from 6 millimeters to 9 millimeters. It grew, but really sort of nothing extraordinary. There's a lapse on ultrasound. There was a 0.9 cm nodule. Cytology was performed. It was Bethesda 4 follicular neoplasm or lesion. It was sent for molecular testing, which revealed NRAS, TERT, and PIK3CA mutations. So with all we know, with all literature in the field, this is a molecular signature of highly aggressive thyroid cancer. That's what we put in the report, that we said that co-occurrence of this mutation confer a very high risk of cancer in increased likelihood of high risk for disease recurrence, that because of the molecular signature of high risk cancer, total thyroidectomy may be considered for many of these patients. And yet this patient underwent lobectomy. They had lobectomy because of the small size. Pathology showed follicular thyroid carcinoma, 1 cm, minimally invasive with tumor capsule invasion and progression to poorly differentiated thyroid carcinoma, confined to thyroid with no angiolymphatic invasion. So based on the presence of poorly differentiated carcinoma, finally, the fact that it had also molecular signature made sense. Patient had completion of thyroidectomy, had radioactive iodine ablation, and 5 months later presented with a T5 vertebral body metastasis from this cancer. So sometimes I'm thinking about cases like this, and I'm trying to understand why with all literature in the field, with all highly consistent data from different studies, different continents, different groups, we are still resistant to accept this molecular signature as something that signify true biologically aggressive thyroid cancers. Probably our comprehension, probably our resistance raises first of all of the fact that we really afraid to overtreat these cancers. We are afraid that if the signature started to show very often, we will overtreat a significant number of cancers to identify those that are very aggressive. It's not really the case. How often do you expect to have this high risk molecular signature? This is just results of one multi-center prospective studies that we published couple years ago on possess the 3 to 5 cytology. There were 257 nodules and 68 of them were cancers. If you look at the high risk signature, we identified 2 patients among the entire study cohort that had high risk signature. So it's 2% of test positive nodules, 0.8% of all tested nodules. And if you look only at cancers, 3% of all thyroid cancers. And that's fit with what we see in a much, much broader now real-time experience. This molecular signature is rare. So we really distill it. We're now not talking about 10 or 15 or 20% of cancers. We are talking about few percentages of cancers that have this signatures that now based on all we know is a signature of aggressive thyroid cancer. And I kind of just want to hope that that we need thought leaders in the field really sort of embrace many of the, which of them are on this symposium, really start embracing it and start to use and sort of help other practitioners to accept this concept, because data are very solid, particularly on tumors that have combination of RAS, BRAF, and TERT mutation in terms of their malignant potential. I think that another reason why we feel still remains kind of resistant to embracing and accepting this concept is that most data are retrospective. And we obviously would like to have prospective data. This also was several times mentioned in Dr. Tuttle talk, to really to be sure that what we do, if we act on this, will affect actually patient survival and affect long-term outcomes for these patients. So we need prospective trials. Some of them are underway. This is one of them led by Dr. Lynn Yip in our institution, who look at the Bethesda 5 and 6 nodules. So nodules that are most likely are cancers, most papillary thyroid carcinomas, and RSI and with nodule size between 1 and 4 cm. With the idea that we know how to manage less than 1 cm nodules, we are comfortable with performing total on more than 4 cm nodules, but this is a group where by ATA, we need re-stratification, risk assessment in order to decide between lobe and total thyroidectomy. We perform molecular testing on the FNAs and then low risk signature, they go for lobe, and a high risk signature go for total thyroidectomy. And the primary outcome of the study is the rate of conversion of lobe to total thyroidectomy after the initial surgery is performed. Based on power calculations, they need 90 patients to be enrolled in this study. Now it's a multi-institutional study. I believe University of Wisconsin, and I think that one more center have just joined the study. There is about 50 patients recruited so far. We really hope that maybe another year or so and the study will be complete, and we are sort of anticipating the results with great interest, because this will be first studies that provide prospective assessment of the role of molecular testing in managing and active in managing at least surgically patients with thyroid nodules. So in summary, I believe we have abundant and highly consistent but retrospective data on molecular markers and the association with low and high risk thyroid cancer, including risk of recurrence, distant metastasis, and survival. We have less data in preoperative FNA setting, but we do have data, and we are going to get more information very soon for specifically FNA setting. And we are waiting for results of prospective studies, which really we believe will define management approaches to patients with thyroid cancer based on molecular profile. But I want to say that buckle up, because we as a field moving with very high speed, and I think that based on the data, based on the biological and clinical data that we have now, it will be very short interval before we really will be able to finally confidently suggest to use of molecular data for preoperative restratification of thyroid cancer. I thank you for your attention.